God is He's able to deliver them.
Scripture reading this morning is taken from Matthew chapter 15, verses 22 through 28. Matthew 15, 22 through 28. And behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and was crying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely oppressed by a demon." But he did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and begged him, saying, "Send her away, for she is crying out after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "O woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire." And her daughter was healed instantly.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I love stories in the Bible that kind of twist and distort everything we think and throw us this huge curveball. I specifically like the teachings of Jesus. I love the fact that Jesus doesn't give us lessons like we're used to hearing. Jesus gives us lessons in real life. He gives real life lessons. He gives a real life lesson through a Canaanite woman. He gives a real life lesson by her faith. And he allows her to teach this lesson by doing something that seems almost backwards to us. This is one of the most difficult passages you're going to find, because she is rewarded and it ends with, "Her faith is great." Do you remember it starts with Jesus saying, I didn't come for the dogs. I'm not here for these dogs. These dogs are not the reason I came. I'm here for the children of Israel, those holy people set apart by God, those who have a purpose, those who I came to teach and restore their nation, those who I came to fulfill the law, those who I came for. I didn't come for these dogs. But that's after she's already said, "Go away." The apostles started. The disciples say, "Go away." She doesn't listen. Okay, this is effective, actually. Second time, Jesus joins in. He says, "Go away." She doesn't. He then tells her that it's not right to take the children's bread and give it to dogs. Calling her a dog, sending her away. And instead of going away, after being told by Jesus, the Messiah, God in the flesh, the only one who speaks with the authority of God, and he says, "Go away," and she doesn't listen. She doesn't listen to him, and then what does she do? She responds that she is a dog. She says, "Yeah, I'm a dog." But the dogs get to eat from their master's table. And Jesus heals her daughter because after everything he told her to do, she didn't listen. After Jesus tells her to do something three times, she doesn't listen. And she goes away with her daughter healed. Matthew accounts it a certain way, and we're going to notice that in Mark's version, he calls her a different type of woman. A Syrophoenician. Mark chapter 7, verse 24. And I want you to see that Mark is more interested in the miracle than he is in the Jewishness of what Jesus did. And so they tell it from different perspective. Because Matthew, a Jew, is going to tell it more Jewish. And then Mark, who is written to Gentiles, is going to make it more sense to us. So Mark chapter 7, starting in verse 24. "And from there he arose and went away to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And he entered a house and did not want anyone to know, yet he could not be hidden. But immediately a woman, whose litter daughter had an unclean spirit, heard of him and came and fell down at his feet. Now, the woman was a Gentile, a Syrophoenician by birth. And she begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. And he said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to dogs." But she answered him, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." And he said to her, "For this statement you may go your way. The demon has left your daughter." And she went home and found the child lying in bed, and the demon gone. At first, we do need to address, some of you may notice, she's a Canaanite woman or a Syrophoenician woman. Because to the Jews, there's Israel, the beautiful, perfect nation. And then there's Canaan, those people that we displaced so we could have the land. To the Gentiles, to the Romans, to the Greeks, obviously they have cities and they care what they're named. Jews just don't care. It's not Israel. They could have put, "She is from a place, not Israel." And it would have been just as good. So, once we get past that, we see this weird story, and this story that doesn't fit with what we're used to. We have this story of faith. We have this story of a practice that seems so foreign to any of us, because how many of us would honestly say that once we come and the religious authorities say, "Stop." Those who are religious authorities, the disciples, they're saying, "Go away. Go away, stop doing what you're doing." And yet she feels that she needs to continue. She has this faith that tells her to go on. This faith that says, "Challenge everything." And she does. And then she gets to Jesus. And you're just expecting this beautiful change because it's Jesus. You come to Jesus, he's supposed to welcome little children. It's supposed to be this story of him teaching and being welcoming and all this. And it's not that story. It's the story of a teacher who takes this moment to teach because he has a student who can teach the crowd more than he could just say. Because how great is it for him to say, "I want you to have the faith to keep asking"? That's not really Jesus' style. Jesus doesn't give boring, old, yell at you, dumb sermons. He is the master teacher. And if you ever want to understand who the greatest teacher is, and yet God puts on flesh and it's Jesus, and you go, "I heard this teacher is better than Jesus," you're an idiot. I'm just saying, you're an idiot. Because the truth is, Jesus has a way of teaching us that is greater than we can even do. Because he understands minds and hearts. He knows that this woman who's coming to him has this great, amazing faith that if he says, "Go away," she ain't listening. He's not afraid that if he says it to her, that this teaching might go wrong. He knows this faith when he meets her. He sees this woman who can teach his disciples something. And so he lets her teach them. And he does that by challenging her. Because if he would have just healed her, would we know her faith? No. She walks up and says, "I would like to be healed." We don't know her faith. We know she had enough faith to go to Jesus. Most of us, if we heard Jesus was in town, down at the convention center, we would probably show up. I mean, just out of curiosity, right? We'd be like, "Let's go see Jesus. This is interesting." But let me show you the second story. There's a second story in this mix. And it's a story that shows nothing of this man's faith. This is the deaf man who gets healed. And I want you to realize that in this story, we know very little about his faith. We know he has a faith like us. Who would we show up? That's about as much as we can guarantee. So starting in Mark chapter 7, verse 31, he starts with this. "Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went to the Sidon, to the Sea of Galilee, in the region of the Decapolis. And they brought to him a man who was deaf and had a speech impediment, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. And taking him aside from the crowd privately, he put his fingers in his ears, and after spitting, touched his tongue. And looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, 'Ephphatha,' that is, be open.' And his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. And Jesus charged them to tell no one. But the more he charged them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. And they were astonished beyond measure, saying, 'He has done all things well. He even makes the deaf hear and mute speak.'" Both are mighty miracles. Healing someone's daughter is no less a miracle than opening his breath, letting him speak, letting words come forth, and letting his ears be open so that he can hear. It's not a difference in miracle, but it's a difference in teaching. What do I learn from that? I learned that he came to God. I learned more about what his problems were than the faith that he had. And it's contrasted in this story of this woman. And if Jesus had just said, okay, come here, your daughter is healed, we learn as much about her as this man's faith. He begs him, he heals him. There you go. We learn as little. But yet Jesus doesn't do things. Jesus always does things in a way that teaches. Sometimes Jesus messes up a healing. Have you ever read that story? Did you know Jesus messes up a healing in the story? He has this blind guy come to him, and he's all like, I'm going to heal you. And he does it once, and he's like, can you see? Nope, I see trees. Okay. Well, it's like I'm looking at trees. And you're like, Jesus, the perfect Messiah, messed up a healing. Jesus, this great healer who has no imperfections, comes in and messes up a healing. So that after he asks him, he says, can you see? Jesus already done the first healing. And he says, well, they're blurry. I see blurry. And he takes him again and he asks him again. He says, can you see? And he can see. And we forget that a lot of things that Jesus does, he doesn't want us to teach him than anything. Because this great teacher who uses so many images, who uses so many parables, who uses everything around him to teach and to connect with the people around him. He used a dog. Pretty decent insult. Good Jews, good Orthodox Jews, would never have a dog. They're unclean. You touch them and get unclean. Kind of problem. Dogs were useful out in the field, but field workers are not exactly considered the most holy people. And what does he say? He says, I've got a table. I've got a table with food. And it's for the children of Israel to eat from. And she comes to him, and she wants some of that table. And he says, you're a dog. You don't think we should take this food from people and give it to dogs, do you? Take it from these children and give it to these dogs. And yet, her faith to just say, as a dog, but even we get crumbs. I just want the crumbs. We go back to the other major unnamed woman of faith, and we see that kind of crumb concept. What does she touch? She doesn't go up to Jesus and go, I need to touch his head. I need to grab his hand. What does she do? She grabs something. The very bottom. She grabs the hem of his garment. Down at the ground. Down low. She's got to be bent over far enough to actually grab this at the bottom of him. And we see this exact same image. This idea that just grabbing just for the tiniest bit. It wasn't as though she thought she was so worthy that she comes up and touches the head of Christ. Grabs the hand of Christ. She comes to him as a dog. Touches the hem. She is healed. And in this, Jesus' story is of a table, and yet the answer is this: if I have to be a dog at my God's table, I will be a dog. And the humility and strength it takes to say, I don't really need to preserve my image. I don't need to show who I am. I don't need to come across as anything. I am a dog, and I'm good with that. The Old Testament speaks of being a servant in the temple, being better than being a king outside the temple. It speaks of those servants who just take the door as great and glorified. And our idea of Christianity being, if we get to be dogs in the church, let us be dogs. Let us look to our master and say, oh, we get some crumbs from that. We look to him and he is glorified, and we're like, thank you for letting us participate. And we show this faith that Jesus has to use a Syrophoenician woman, a Canaanite woman, to teach us. A message that we may not get. Because the trickiest part about Christianity is not where we become, where we become children of God. We love to talk about becoming children of God in this glorified state. We hate talking about the state that we have to come in to enter his kingdom. The story of the rich man. Jesus said, it's easier. Remember those stories? Jesus loves stories, and I don't know if he's the greatest teacher ever. Yes! And he goes and he's got this story, and he says, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle, that's a normal-sized door, I'm trying to imagine a camel, to get through this ducking down, crawling on his knees or something, and just squeezing through that door. We avoid that image. Because the idea that for a second we have to be dogs, we're not really comfortable. That when we fully come to God, it's a matter of repentance, not because we can find something we did wrong, but because we know that we have done wrong. Because we look at ourselves and we say we truly are dogs. Because when we compare ourselves to our Messiah, our King, we are. When we compare ourselves to our God, we are nothing but worms. And if we start out by saying that we are worms, God takes that and does something mighty with that. But he never gives this idea that it's automatic or easy or any of that. Because people will oppose us. We are unworthy. Christ says we are unworthy. Bible teaches we are unworthy. And yet we need to come with the same faith this woman has. This woman who taught us that if we call ourselves dogs, we can come in as dogs in his kingdom. And I would much rather be a dog in his kingdom than a man outside. Be it a servant at his doorstep. Than a king ruling a nation. And that is the call of the invitation to him. He's perfect, he's mighty, he's holy, he's amazing. Anytime anybody comes before the very presence of God, they do the same thing. I can't do it. I don't know what it is, whether it's Moses, Elijah, Isaiah, they come before God and they say the same thing. I can't do it. Because they come to the presence of God. And it's the only logical response is to come to the presence of God and say, it ain't gonna work. I just saw you. Have you seen me? And the truth is, in that humility of saying that, you know what, we're willing to serve God no matter what we look like. We're willing to serve God no matter what it requires us to do. No matter what it requires us to face, we are willing to have the faith to stand up and do that. We're willing to have the faith to push through whatever we have to do to serve him. And that is the only invitation where we can take something and transform it. Because until we are clay in his hands, still his image, he says until we are clay, he doesn't mold us. Until we are the clay that he can make something great out of, because he is the potter, he can't make something great out of us. We just stay a lump of clay. And so he offers an invitation to believe who Jesus is. But in seeing Jesus as Lord, we also are called to repent through that. We're called to repent through a faith of who he is, because we see who he is and we understand we are not worthy. And our unworthiness leads to a repentance of asking him to forgive us for what we are. Then we confess him as Lord, us unworthy dogs, confessing him, barking at his door, confessing him as Lord. Being buried with him in baptism so that this old dog self is raised a child, is raised a son of God, a term that no Israelite could ever say. that they are actually the sons of God. And then to live for Him in that new state, no longer as dogs, but as children, where we serve Him as our Father and our King. Today, if there's anybody who needs to respond to that, if there's anybody who needs prayers today, or if there's anybody who wishes to submit to the eldership here, as we stand and as we sing, we ask that you would